One, two. One, two. Okay, we've got sound. Again, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Keran Deterville. I'm one of your moderators for the evening. Our guest of honor just arrived, so we're ready to start. Thank you to the Brooklyn Public Library for partnering with us. We are the team from Tropicalfete, and we'll get right to it. So our opening act this evening, one of the youngsters from our PAN program, the Tropicalfete Ensemble. And tonight we have with us Natalie, who's going to give us a PAN rendition of Sugar Bombo. Thank you. And Tropicalfete, we used to rent the space. Now we have our own home. So our new location, there's a brand new complex on New York Avenue and Linden. So the entire bottom is Tropicalfete. So feel free to stop by.
Need some money. this one.
So as I was saying, our new home. Can you hear me now? Very nice. So we're on New York Avenue and Linden. There's a brand new complex right on the corner. So the entire ground floor is Tropicalfete. We offer pants, tilt, walking. We now have yoga. We have guitar. So feel free to stop by, enroll the young people. If you've always wanted to learn pan, we have no age limit. So I think our oldest tilt walker was in the 70s. So everyone is welcome. And we have a lot of free programs as well. So please join us. And we are a working crew. So you'll get to take part in many, many activities. Up next, ladies and gentlemen, we are sticking with pan. And we'll have two selections from Faye. And I'll give you my mic, Faye. Thank you. Stay, guys. Stay 1 second. Don't go yet. Thank you. A round of applause again for Faye. So you two can play like they. Or get on here. So you are who?
Empress. And
what are you doing?
I am mom. These are my oldest, my youngest, and my oldest.
So it's a family affair. So this is mom and her two girls. So we invite you guys to come down, check us out at tropicalfete.com, and you can sign. You can find something to sign up for. Okay. There are persons that we partner with, and you know, they're always behind the scenes working. They don't like attention, but not with me. This lady here, what's your name?
Winsome Cortez.
Kerwin Pilgrim.
And Kerwin Pilgrim. The reason I singled them out, they are from the Brooklyn Public Library, this location, Grand Army Plaza to be exact. And they've partnered with us, putting on these presentations, and they've worked extremely hard to make sure things got off the ground. So these are only two of the presentations we've had so far. So we had Nyla, and tonight we're having Kes, and we are bringing a whole lot more for you. But please remember the library. Even when Kes, Nyla, and the others are not here, there is always something going on here. Support your local library. There's so much happening here today. Buzzing, there's the 50th anniversary of hip hop. So Grand Army Plaza this month, this year has been popping. So bring the kids. There's something for everyone. We support them. So we ask you to support them at this time. Kerwin, please come front. And he's a library man, but I think he has a mass bone. Every bone in his body is mass.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. After hearing the pan, I felt like jumping up myself, but I had to restrain myself. Thank you, Keran. Thank you, Tropicalfete, our wonderful partners that is working with us to really bring Caribbean culture to, obviously, the library and to our communities. My name is Kerwin Pilgrim. I'm the Director of Adult Learning at Brooklyn Public Library. Adult Learning is a department that really works with all of our adult literacy students, as well as students who are looking to improve their English language proficiency. And we also work with job seekers, entrepreneurs, and investors. So within just my department, we have tons of programs to help people improve their lives and reach their goals. So as sort of an extension of that, we also value cultural education and diversity. And we've been working with Tropicalfete to put on mini carnivals, this series, the 50th anniversary of Soca series, and we're hoping to grow the program in. So thank you all for showing up this evening. We hope we could continue to grow the audiences and programs. Thanks again, okay?
Thank you very much. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, I'll call one of the hardest working men in Brooklyn. He's our president, the founder of tropicalfete.com and Tropicalfete, the entire program, Mr. Alton Abam. Alton wants me to hand him the mic.
This was a little inside joke because I'm getting old. Last week I jumped off the stage and hurt my leg, so I'm walking with a cane now. So I'm here. I'm here because I love the culture, I love the community, and want to thank the Brooklyn Public Library for partnering up with to do this event. And you don't know the struggles behind trying to make this happen, trying to push Caribbean music, trying to push Caribbean cultures. We live in the U.S., everything boils down to numbers, how much music you could sell, how much people you could bring to the shows. But I always think our culture have value, and it's just a matter of how we present it. And to have this program in this institution, the Brooklyn Public Library, you know, tells a lot in terms of where we want our music to go and how we want our music and our culture to, you know, be recognized. So if you guys could give a big round of applause to the Brooklyn Public Library for just the fights that we had to make this happen. And then more people are calling, want to see programs with some of the elders, and that's some of the conversations that we currently having behind the background in terms of not just looking at the new generation of artists, but also the pioneers, the people who paved the way, because as a result of them, we are able to be here. You know, even people like Carlos Lozama, who started the Carnival, and Rudy King, who brought Steel Pan to New York, these are pioneers that gave us the foundation to build on. So we just paying tribute to that by having the kids here. And then one of the things I want to say, we are family atmosphere. We welcome everybody, no matter where you're from, what race, what creed you are. We are one big, happy Caribbean family. We only just say we need to do it professionally and do it with ethics to actually move our product and our vehicle forward. Because personally, I'm tired of seeing us do the same thing over and over again. And certain protocols need to be in place for us to move forward. So just thanks for having us and check us out. I think we're going to be starting a number of programs in our new location. Everything from steel pan to stills to guitar to violin to piano, arts and craft. Just today we had 6 events, and one is going on as we speak, happening yoga every Thursdays and Mondays and Sunday morning. So feel free to check us out, support us. And also tomorrow we are hosting the Trinidad and Tobago Steel Orchestra, doing another workshop on the single pan instrument. It's a free event at our location, but we're asking for donations. And also on Saturday, we're having another jam session with the police band at the 67 precinct. And they're gonna be going back in the next, I think, on Friday. So just come out and support them. And we're looking to just not only cultivate here, but also invite people from all parts of the Caribbean. I know we just had the Tobago group, and we're also talking to bringing Virgin Islands group, and different groups are reaching out to us to just give them a platform to just showcase our world, export it to the world, and that's how we could have an economy and a family. So just thank you very much.
Thank you, Alton. So again, our location, we're on New York and Linden. So feel free to stop by. If you can take the classes, we would welcome having your kids, the instruments, stilt walking, pan. Can we do art, Alton? I want to learn how to paint.
Yeah, so Natoya does art and pottery along with Mr. Charles, who's in the back taking photos. So these are one of the programs we do in the schools. I think right now we work at 7 public schools and definitely going to be increasing this year, and also 5 senior centers. So anything to do with arts and culture, creativity, that's what we're all about. Just give people a platform to express themselves and actually to find their culture and a belonging. That's all we're here to do. Thanks.
Thank you. And this gentleman over here is renowned pianist Ricardo Green. So he's also one of our instructors. So, and I'm sure he's book solid. He plays all over. I'm sure you've seen him on social media. But he always makes time to work with the kids. So he's not playing today, but he made it his duty to be here today. So welcome, Mr. Green, and thank you. Mr. DJ, just a tune while we get ready to start. I think if I have not received your question, you still have time to document it, and they'll get it to me. One.
This work, sign me up, I come for it. Boss lady, I come for this work. Sign
Okay. We'll start off with a short video before we bring out our guests. One, two. Okay, we're on. Ladies and gentlemen, if you were here for Nyla, this is Pat. Now, Pat, I call her the encyclopedia of Caribbean music. Pat basically knows something about everyone from Rose to Sparrow to Charlie's to Nyla to Kes. So every time we go somewhere, I'm like, okay, Pat, everybody just, hey, Pat. Kes walked in and Kes like, hey, Pat. So she covers Caribbean music extensively, especially reggae. Pat is always somewhere. Either she's in St. Kitts. When you think she's in St. Kitts, she's in Jamaica. She's in St. Lucia. Actually, when we met Nyla, I thought, you know, we'll go and introduce ourselves to Nyla. And Nyla remembered, and Pat remembered, before Nyla really exploded, they brought Nyla to a hotel room in Barbados with a guitar. And she played for Pat way before she became popular. So they go way back. So she has intimate stories with Kes, and she was just telling me in the back, she was in Jamaica walking, and Kes was just walking the street. And they walked back to the hotel together. So. Not that kind of walking. Caribbean people. So it's a pleasure sitting with her. She's the pro. I love working with Pat because she gets you all the answers, and she knows things that perhaps I would not know. And I think the artists, they love working with Pat because she always presents it the way it should be presented, and she does her homework, she knows her stuff. I was just asking a question right as she walked in. I said, have you ever worked with Burning Spear? And she said, as a matter of fact, just was it a week ago, 2 weeks ago? She had an interview with him at his hotel, and she knows everything about the album that's coming out. So, Pat is the person. If you see Pat in Manhattan, do you have Patti LaBelle tickets, or that she may be able to get you some? So, we're ready. You want to introduce him, Pat?
Yes. Good evening, everyone. And first, I want to say thank you, Keran, for that slightly embellished introduction, but I appreciate it anyway. And a special good night to everyone who was with us last week for Nyla Blackman's interview. That was the first in our Soca Conversation Series. We had a great night, and it's great to see you all here tonight. I just want to say briefly that I'm a Tropicalfete board member, but I'm also a journalist. That's my day job, so to speak. And the catalyst for us doing this, one of the catalysts, I should say, was a story I wrote for NPR Music celebrating 50 years of Soca. Came out in February, right around carnival time. And it was a year-by-year look at 50 songs that kind of traced the trajectory and development of the music, the different styles. And that's something that we're trying to do with this series. Granted, it wouldn't be necessarily in the same chronological order, and I don't think we're going to be able to cover all 50 years one by one, but it's what we're trying to achieve with this series, just to highlight the different sounds in the music, the different movements, the different artists from different eras. So I know you'll enjoy tonight's conversation with Kees, and thank you so much for coming out.
Ladies and gentlemen, you know him as the lead singer with the band, one of the most exciting singer-songwriters to come out of the Caribbean in a very long time. I believe Grammy nominated. The lead is your eyes are just... Huh? And he just won a Caribbean Music Award.
Yes.
Very nice. And you guys did your homework. You all are ready to chat? Ladies and gentlemen, international superstar, Mr. Kees Dieffendthaller. Welcome to the public library.
Thank you.
Welcome to Brooklyn. Oh, hold on. Just so you want to make me look bad, hold on.
Uh-huh. to dress up. To dress up. Unbutton something. Mm-hmm. Unbutton something. Yeah, now we good, now we good.
I feel like I'm writing a book report. questions upon questions. First off, how are you?
I am I'm good. Been working hard, and it's good to be in New York, you know, and see another year, you know, see New York again, you know. Always good.
Very nice. So what brought you to New York this time besides Tropicalfete?
Many things, you know, we other than shows, we have meetings, we have studio, we have, you know, we just kind of keep it multifunctional and as well too, you know, just to have a good time, see people I didn't see for a while.
Very nice.
Yes.
Now, whether you're from Haiti, St. Lucia, Grenada, Guyana, we know Kees. Let's start by you telling us a little bit about Kees the man. Where were you born?
I was born in Trinidad, yes. Born in Port of Spain, but grew up in San Fernando. Big up the South, every time. And, you know, we grew up in a home that loved music, loved the arts, loved calypso, loved rock music. You know, I really am grateful for the household, my parents, my brothers, my sister. We all, music and creativity was the common denominator. Whether things were good or bad, that was there, you know? So, you know, we grew up in South Trinidad, having dreams as every kid would have. My big brother actually is the one that really pushed us into music in a different way, other than school and choir and all of that. He used to go by his friend, Nicholas Als, who had a dish. He was one of the few people that had American TV in a way. And he would see Van Halen, you know, the rock band with, yeah. So, you know, Eddie and Anthony were, not Anthony, Eddie and his other brother, the drummer, they were their brothers. So in his mind, he was like, I have brothers. Maybe they could play something and we could start a band, you know? We had no equipment. We didn't have anything in those days. And I always remember him and his friends building a drum kit from buckets, you know? And stretching plastic and tuning toms and a hi-hat with a klimpan cover and a spring and a... And, you know, my other brother, was who plays guitar now, he was playing bass then, and he had a nail for a pickup, and like his... And my dad felt sorry for us, and he got some secondhand equipment for us. And we would just practice every day in the garage. And then one day we wanted to build a stage and have a concert. We couldn't even saw like the first piece of wood. Using cocaine and all kind of thing to try. But in the hot sun in Trinidad. But then my dad again felt sorry for us, and he got one of the guys who worked for him in the office to help build a stage. And we built a stage, and we did a little concert for our friends, you know? And it was rock music. It wasn't soca or calypso. And that was integral. I think we never forgot that and kept building from that point, you know, to now.
Now, in the back, we were speaking about your father. In doing our research, I came across a clip, and it said, that's your dad. But I had never recognized him from soca or calypso circles. But when he spoke, he was very artsy. There was something very mass-like about his tone and his presentation. And I know he played a role in your upbringing and this music thing. And also, there are many clips of you and this young woman, your mother. You all are either dancing in a kitchen. There's always a vibe between you and your mom. So Yes. Tell me about your relationship with both mom and dad, and what role that plays in your career.
I give thanks for them, because they were scared and supported anyway. It's not easy for parents. They're three big sons, you know. Their big sons have sense in their head, as they say. They could go to school. We could have done university. We could have done all of it. But we wanted to do music, and they were there. And you know, there were moments of worry, but generally it's full love and full support. And, you know, my mom was like, you know, if you want to be a garbage man, be the best garbage man you could be, you know, in a sense. But in other words, just be successful and do what you have to do. And they've always been there for us. Every step of the way, you know, they would be there encouraging. I'd still hear my dad saying, go, Kessie, like I would still hear him. You know, my aunt. My mom was the she sings classical, and she did a lot of, you know, operatic music, arias, all of that. And she got me more into the formal side of things, and got me really understanding the mechanism of singing, breathing, the discipline of theater and choir and drama and all of these things were a part of my upbringing as well. Daddy was the bacchanalist, so he showed us the real world, you know, the real people. And the combination, I think, up to this day, is a part of me. It's the way I navigate through the world, is from what they've shown me with everything they have, you know?
Very nice.
Yeah.
Good evening, Kes.
Good evening.
One of the things that's so distinctive about Kes the band is what you bring to Soca, just these different musical influences. And as you've outlined, you know, you come from a home where your mom's trained in classical music. Your brothers had a rock band. At a point, I believe you had an R&B group,
yeah,
while they had the rock band, mm-hmm, or close to one another. Then you joined up with them, so you're bringing that influence into the rock band.
Yes.
And eventually, well, to even go back, because I don't want to skip over this, that you, when you joined the group, it was to enter a talent contest.
Yes.
And you sang Queen's Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yes.
Obviously, you sang it very well, because I believe you won the contest.
We won, yeah.
From that point on, I believe too that you and your brothers then became a part of Image and Company.
Yeah.
How did that journey begin? Like, so jump that transition for you and your brothers from the R&B you were involved in, the rock that they were involved in, coming together, and then making that jump into the Soca circuit.
Well, I think that competition was amazing for us. We did Bohemian Rhapsody together because, yes, that R&B group, we could have done the classical part and all the a cappella stuff, and of course, they would handle the rock, and we won. And I think at that point in time, a light bulb switched in all of us when we realized, yo, we love this. Like, we want to do this. We have no gigs or no sure future in this, but we love it. And it kind of brought us back memories to when we were kids, you know? And we just rolled in the trenches after that, you know? We formed a group called Rhythmurai, which was like an original band group where we would make our originals and play it alongside covers. And just, you know, that's just how we were moving along. We play anywhere, you know, weddings, the casino, wherever was giving us somewhere to go. But there was this one trip, we went to Grenada, my first tour out of Trinidad. Went to Grenada to play for the university, and I had lint in my pocket, didn't even have like a cent. I have like the promoter buying toothpaste for us, and like, it's like, sad. However, we were like the happiest we've ever been. Like my brother was working in a engineering job. The bassist was a chemical engineer. And they used to have to leave practice and go to work and come back and stuff like that. And we were on the beach drinking Canadian Caribbean, eating pizza, and was like, my brothers was like, I'm gonna go home and quit my job. This is what I wanna do. And so said, so done, they did that. And then we sort of just locked down and got really militant. We were young, we had energy. So any show that we got, we were like, we have to nail it. We would take our entire salary and get the best engineer we know so that we'd sound good. We wouldn't necessarily make money on that show, but we sound good and we get four other shows because we sounded good, you know? So we did that as kids, and we go into Coconuts, and then they liked us. And then we end up playing for their Christmas party, you know, and then the Oliers night, wow. You know, and it was sort of like strength to strength, and we used every opportunity that came, and we tried to maximize it. And then two of the members within the band, two of my mates I was working with from the R&B group, wanted to go to university, of course. We were that age, 18, 19. Mm-hmm. One of them went to study telecommunications, and one of them actually went to Juilliard, you know, music school in Manhattan. He had a dream. Yeah, Michael Zephyrin, he had a dream to do that. Everybody thought it was impossible, and he did it. But that kind of changed the dynamic of the group, and we still wanted to do something. But at that time, we met Joey from Second Image, and he saw us play at a charity show. And we nailed it, like we kill it, sound just like whoever, you know? Yeah. Mad. And then, well, he saw something in us and was like, yo, I wanna bring back Image. And we were like, we loved them in the 80s because they were like the soca band with the rock guitar.
Yes.
Like they had a distortion and we liked that, you know? It was like, that makes sense. So we went and we said, yeah, sure, because two of our members going away, timing is perfect. We went into it with Joey, and that kind of started my journey in soca and sort of understanding soca, because we were green, you know? Green mangoes, you know? So Riyadh used to like dance like that, you know? You see Riyadh now is, but he used to like do our government boots, you know? Like, and we were like, that's not gonna work though. But we learned, you know? Along the way, we learned through that world. Edwin Yearwood, had such great songs, but that R&B twist was something I loved. So yeah. My approach to soca was sort of like, let me put some of those things. And so my early soca is like Pushback and One Day, and all these things had a sort of R&B, almost gospel kind of twisted. So that was the beginning, you know, into soca, through Julia and them, yeah.
And how many years was it with Image and Company before you broke off on your own?
It was 5 years.
Okay.
So we really got huge because, well, the reality is that we kind of stepped into a minor situation because Second Image in the 90s, they had a situation that happened that they kind of fell out with the powers, you know, that be. They had a thing that happened, but we didn't know any of that. Right. So when we came in, I realized that it's just real hard to get airplay. Like, I didn't know what was going on. And then I got his story, and I was like, wow, so like how am I going to even get an air? Because they know I'm under them, you know? And so I actually took my song, Pushback, and I made a CD, and I didn't put Image, I put KES. And they played it, and they liked it. And then 2 weeks before Carnival, off. I didn't hear nothing. And I was like, what's up? Why? So then another artist came up to me and was like, they threw your song in the bin. I wanted to sink, I wanted to die. I was like 19, you know? My heart's gone. I was like, what, why? So our carnival came and went, and then I got a call from New York saying that they wheeled the song 15 times in a boat ride, and I was like. But I didn't go to New York till 10 years later.
Oh, really?
So the struggle continued because we were, you know, but that now made us resourceful. So, all right, cool, we're not getting airplay. We played for schools. We played for corporate. We played for everything outside. If we get 2-3 fets in Carnival, cool. But we playing for the rest of the year. And we started to build a fan base where the daughters of... the daughters of men. No, they don't. The daughters of the program directors was like, why are you not playing our favorite band? And eventually, we started to squeeze in. We would have to build songs live. We're not getting airplay, so we're building songs live. It was only after Whatless that things started to become a little easier.
Yeah.
But that was 10 years of the boonies, you know, a desert. Yeah.
But, I mean, Whatless was...
Whatless was
and still so popular.
Yes, a teacher.
But before we even want to talk about that song, but before that, even the origin of the name Kess the Band.
Yeah.
Your name is Kees.
Yeah.
Pronounced Kess.
Right. So what happened? What happened was. So when we left Image, it was sort of a little tension, you know. But people knew who I was. And my brother was like, yo, instead of us calling a band, a whole new band name, let's just do it as Kess. K-E-S, like Kiss, you know, but Kess, you know? Uh-huh. Like, I was kind of weird about it because I was like, You know, like Sade's real name is not Sade, that kind of thing, you know? But cool, I kind of went with it. And but in soca, of course, you could sing on tracks and with your DJ, or you could sing with your band. And depending on what you're trying to do, you might do both. So people were like, who playing on the show? Kes or Kes on the band? Or Kes the band playing? Who playing? So it just eventually became Kes the band, because we're a band, you know? It's not like me alone. It's like, it's an energy with Robbie and guitarists, and everybody has a vibe, you know? So people started to call us Kes the band. And we, you know, voice of the people, you know?
Absolutely.
Just kept it in a way.
Great one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I've known a lot of persons who are in band, and one of the hardest things is to keep a band together, to keep the members happy, whether it's brothers, sisters, but to stay as a unit and move forward successfully as a unit, one body. Mm-hmm. How has that experience been with the band, especially when you are the face of the band?
It's a soul tribe, you know, because I do what I do, but everyone plays a role. And kind of like without everybody, if my outside engineer is not doing his job, I could do whatever I want on stage. You know, I'm not going to sound good. So, you know, there is a soul group. It's a kind of gang. It's a kind of, I don't know how I can explain it. It's sort of like a brotherhood and a family that if you're not vibrating within that sort of way, it just naturally sort of like happens, you know? Of course, there's members who you know, left along the way, but not many, you know. And then there's some who left and came back in a different capacity. So it's such a journey, and I feel like I kind of trust the process. I trust that the soul connection will dictate the movements and where we go, you know. So
now, that's the way you described it. The average person would not describe it that way. I remember speaking to a lady about this evening, and she's Haitian. And the way she described you, she said, I like him because he's Woodstocky. So I asked her, what does that mean? She said, if you follow the story of Woodstock, they were basically flower people. But Woodstock was people basically marinating. They were of love. And when people listen to you, whether it's the music or in a setting like this, you always sort of exude love and togetherness. You think that has something to do with the success, not only of Kes, but Kes the band?
I reincarnated from the 60s. No, I mean, yeah, I think generally, you know, for me, people are people. You know, when I was young, I didn't get my license till late, you know? Like, I had a little fear of it. And I would travel a lot. But in traveling, I would sit and talk to so many different people. Like, I would just randomly, and I was not famous or anything. I would just pick up conversations with people. And people inspire me. And I think if your cup is too full all the time, you're not gonna be inspired. You're not gonna be in wonder about who's coming with a message. And anybody could come with a message that connects dots for me. So I kind of like try to empty myself. I forget what we were talking about in the beginning, but I try to empty myself for the moment to receive, to understand, okay, cool, yo, why is this person telling me this? So like, you know, somebody made something random, but they don't know that what they were saying is totally in line with what's happening in my life right now. So like, I see God working through people in a way like that. So I'm respectful. I'm not saying sometimes I may not lose patience, you know, as everyone, you know, or not being I don't want to take pictures, or I want to deal with a tabanka or whatever it is I want to deal with and be a human, you know? And that's always a struggle, but, you know, more so I just kind of like appreciative of who you are, you know? And I I'm glad that that translates to people because it's exactly how I feel. Like, why can't we all just get along kind of way, you know?
And you think that's a universal message. For example, if you're in this setting, you could say, well, it's predominantly Caribbean. But when you step out of this circle, there's no changing of kes. Kes is kes, and the message is always the same.
I admire people. I admire the Dalai Lama and the Vigrant for being themselves, you know? In every frame, you know, we spend a lot of times putting on masks, you know, and it's heaven to simplify into one house, you know, and I feel like I have an opportunity to do that, so why not? I'm gonna be who I am and not have to put, so I have to put on this mask. Like, I actually have a luxury to just be like, cool, you know what I mean? And I take full advantage of that, you know?
Very nice.
Yeah.
Kes, you, the band, you have a very deep catalog. I mean, we're going to get into all the big crates, absolutely. Before, we're going to get into all the big Soca hits, but I'd like to go back to kind of pre-what list to ask about a couple of songs. Yeah. One is the beautiful song Lion, which is so inspirational, so lovely, and I wonder if you would plan to re-release it. I mean, it's not like you have to redo it. It's just so nice and so beautifully constructed and all of that. I wonder if there's any thoughts to doing that, or do you perform it anywhere? Might not work in a fete necessarily, but maybe in some of your other shows.
I try to do it when I think it suits the situation. It's a song that song was so powerful and important for me because that was the time when I was feeling to like give up, which happens a few times. And you know, I am a lion. Yes, I'm a fighter. For my book, yes, I'll be the writer. Blaze up your fire, mister, here's your lighter. Writer, come again. And it's about just finding that inner strength within you. And I remember I was doing that song. I was doing a lot of productions in Los Angeles. And I was working with, people from all over, you know? The guy who did David Bowie's album actually recorded Lion. So, you know, I was working with Desmond Child, who wrote Living on a Prayer. And, like, I was working with, like, some amazing people in that world, but here it is in Soca. I can't get two songs to play on the radio for like in Trinidad. So it was sort of like I had a bitterness towards like the two worlds. I was like, why I'm doing all of these things? Why am I not? So even with Lion, I remember I was in the studio. I cry and thing, and I sleep in the night in the studio, and it just ended up being such a powerful song. One of my dad's favorite songs, he played every day in his car, you know, for years afterwards. And that song, again, I came to Trinidad, I went to contemporary radio and be like, yo, it's not Soca, but you know what, guy who did David Bowie's album did it, and it's amazing music. We use live instruments, everything. And they say it's not their format or something like that. But we played it in a show, in a charity show, and it played on TV. And they played the live version on TV so much that people started to like it and knew it. So God has always find a way, you know? And you do have to study that gonna happen as it should. And I feel like I would do it. Like, I feel like that live aspect is the way that I would want to do it, you know? Just have a pristine live recording of it and bring it out in that way, you know? Yeah.
And the other song I wanted to ask about is Stalker. And I wondered if, you know, it almost has kind of like an 80s new wave kind of sound to it. And again, the diversity of Kes the band to be able to vacillate between all these different sounds. But I wondered, you know, given who you are and what you do for a living, if you've had experience with real life stalkers, and were there any situations that maybe worried you?
Woo! That song is like of a real thing. yeah, you get zealous. I call it a little zealous. Yeah, you know, these things happen.
In actuality, I had a song, in a party, don't man, Zanilla, we love, oh man. She was in a bougainvillea. I caught any bougainvillea, basically, but that really happened. Like, I was in Cayman Islands, and it was our last night, and, you know, I swooped my clothes, sweat, and whatever, and I put in, like, my jersey to dry, and, like, I had a pack in, like, 2 hours, and just there in the porch, cooling out, and then I see this bush moving. And then I see this girl slowly stands up out of the like, hey. And she actually wanted me to sign something or something. And I was like, yo, like, come on, you know? And I just never left me. Right. And I, you know, I wrote about it. I had to write a song about it.
Great.
Yeah. I did. I was in shock, but I did anyway, you know? Was there? How long were you there?
Okay, so we have we are taking questions. I think we have questions coming via social media, and we have persons here who have already documented their questions. So apologies if they're all over the place, but we just want to give everyone an opportunity to ask the question. So this one, do you feel like soca music is heading in a direction that can secure its legacy and longevity?
Yeah, I would say yes, because I think that soca and calypso has had their moments. You know, sometimes it was close to doing what it, you know, the explosion worldwide. But I feel like calypso and soca's story is still being told. Like, we're still, as much as we like to compare ourselves to reggae and dancehall and Afrobeat and stuff, they, to me, kind of like on, they have their story and their trajectory. I feel like, yeah. And I think we need to realize that, because what we have is very ancient, you know, 1911, around there's the first calypso has been recorded, you know, they influenced popular music in the Western Hemisphere, you know? So we have a foundation and a root that is there already. It's always gonna be there. But I think two things are happening. The walls have been breaking down with respect to, like, where you're gonna see me perform, where you're gonna see Nyla perform, where you're gonna see all these people perform, what rooms we're entering into now. It's quite different than it was 10 years ago. You know, the impact, you know, sometimes you would have to pay artists to be on a track long ago, you know, that's our reality. But now, it's none of that. There's a mutual respect, and I think it's because sonically and even marketing-wise, these things are reaching a different place. And the second part is that I think things heavy, and people want to feel good, and I feel like soca now is now stepping into a position where we could provide that escape, that togetherness in a separate world. It can be the ultimate revolution, just like how reggae music in the 70s needed to be that voice, needed to echo what James Brown was singing in his music as well, because there was a time and unrest that needed to happen. But I feel like now, we're like fighting for humanity now, and we're at a crossroad where all the things that remind us of our humanity is important, and soca and the fets and calypso and the movement is togetherness, is the definition of where three or more are gathered, you know? It's like, it is us together in all walks, you know? I see my boy Jeff here, you know? But I'll see so many different people from all around the world enjoying the same song or the same vibe. Yeah, I don't see that everywhere. I don't see that in other genres as much as I see it in soca, you know?
I think you just answered this question. How do you see soca and the sound evolving with this new generation?
I mean, I think it's a boat. It's like a tree. Take care of your roots. Understand what the rudiments is. And grow the tree as far and wide as possible. Have fun with it. So, like, to me, once you have a knowledge of where this come from and that rukungs, that heartbeat, that you know the difference between this genre and any other. You could put anything on top of that. You could, your tones could be different, but the swing is what it is, you know? So yeah, I think it's still there. I think to me, the songs that feel more calypso end up being the big songs. Like What Less is a kind of calypso vibes. Like, you know, Hello is my attempt of sort of modernizing calypso, you know? Savannah Grass. It's Kaiso, you know? But these songs are the biggest ones, you know? So that tells me something, you know?
Go ahead.
Going back to What Less now, 2011, I believe you won International Soca Monarch mm-hmm. with that song.
Yeah.
And wonder. Fantastic song, still gets you know, some of the biggest reactions at your shows. But I wondered how, having such a big hit that year, how did that change the trajectory of the band, the, you know, and did the financial situation change for the band too? Because sometimes you hear of artists, they have a really big song and you think, wow, they must be doing really well, and the financial reality is not the same as just having a popular song.
How popular
song.
You are. Yeah.
But what, in a nutshell, what did What Less do for the band?
What Less was like a slap in the face, like a cough in the nose. Because it was beautiful, but yet it was also revealing. It taught me a lot. I call What Less the great teacher, because it taught me about soca, and when the people of your song, and what that means, and what that vibration is. I didn't know that before. I feel like I was skimming the surface, you know, and then What Less was sort of like a deep dive into like Soca 101. I mean, as touring, as, you know, vibes from other artists and like all kind of things was happening. And yes, financially, all those things, we touring, you know, 5 shows in different places in 6 days and living What Less, living, you know, just, you know, and, you know, I have to thank my team and my people for sort of keeping me grounded and keeping a place for me to feel safe and all of that. Because a hit is great, you know, but it comes with everything else too now. Right. And the pressure of the next year, you know? It's like, we're coming with now What Less? We're coming with, you know? A lot of people expected another What Less, but I wasn't there. I was, you know, I wanted to do Tuesday on the Rocks. I wanted to do Stress Away. I wanted to do different things. Mm-hmm. And it was met with like kind of weird vibes, but that again was part of the lesson. You stick to your guns. All those songs are relevant, you know? What Less will always be What Less, you know? And, you know, so it taught me quite a lot, and it was a turning point in my career, and I started to see more places. Mm-hmm. And Jamaica opened up. It was significant. The Jamaican people and musicians love What Less. You the man sing What Less, man. Come in the studio, man. I say, cool. And then, well, yeah, I met, you know, Tuesday on the Rocks, Endless Summer, all these things kind of came out of What Less. From the soca song, which I felt like, all right, actually, two things. I actually didn't know What Less was gonna be so big. I thought A Ting was gonna be the song. I was like, What Less is a nice song. The old people gonna like it, you know? But it was a cool breeze. Yeah, exactly. Somebody's like, what? Because I was just so, I guess, jaded in a way. Some of my friends was like, yo, you're a monster. I was like, for real? You sure? Because I didn't want to put my heart into that and it's broken, you know? But then it did more than I ever thought it would. But then it also opened doors. Like, I didn't think that song was going to open. I thought Lion might have opened my door, or like more of the pop stuff or whatever it is. But the soca opened all the doors. And that time I saw my gain. Like, yo, amazing. We have it, you know? So, yeah. And I wasn't going to enter Soca Monarch because I didn't like competition. Funny, competition was getting too bitter and it was getting too... And I was like, I'm not doing it. And my team was like, Kes, No, do it for the people. And I was like, yo, you know what? That makes sense because, well, no, that was, I really give trouble. Like, like somebody else registered this song for me. Like, I didn't want to do it. And, you know, it was definitely an important thing to do. I may not be into the competition thing, but for the people to see you, represent your song. People love the song. So, you know, represent the song for them too, you know. They like the drama of it. Get them my vibes. So.
Exactly.
Cool.
And all the hit songs that Kees the Band has had, and there's been so many from Wordless coming up, all the soca hits or the things that go into other genres, you've written or have co-written all of them.
Yeah.
And it's just just wanting to highlight you as a songwriter, which is phenomenal work.
Thank you.
Really phenomenal work. And obviously a great gift, because there's many artists who sing beautifully, but they can't write songs. So it's such a strength to be able to compose for yourself and then be the person who goes out and delivers those songs. But I wonder, do you have a certain approach to songwriting? Is it, do you write to the rhythms? Do lyrics come into your head? Or is it all different ways, just depending on whatever the song is?
Yeah, if I think about it too much, I get anxious, yes? Because, you know, it's kind of coming always.
Mm-hmm.
I like to work with people as well, because sometimes being in your own head, you could pigeonhole your writing and it could sound the same, and you know. And then if somebody wrote something for me that I think is amazing and it fits, I'm gonna go for that too, because that as well now stretches my creativity. Mm-hmm. It forces me to sort of explore melodies that I may not have made myself. But for me, with writing a song, it come down to the rudiments, the truth of the track. Like, when I heard, like, Boss Lady's music, like, that video with me and my mom dancing and stuff like that, as me writing the song, I like, this thing have a song in it. And it didn't come yet. It's on its way. But there is a song in this, and I need to trust that's my antennas. Like, this have a song in it, and I have to, like, now, it's almost as if I see the end product, and then I'm carried all the way back to the start, and I have to walk towards the end again. Mm-hmm. And that's how I write, in a sense. I would hear the piece of music the first day, and I'm like, this have a song in it. All right. And I put it aside as on my playlist that I repeat in the car. You know? Even with Hello, like, that rhythm, I was like, this rhythm is fire. Like, this song is there. And I'm driving home and I'm horrible day I've had. And I'm so out of it. And then I was like, hello, 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 hello. And I was just like, this is it. Now, I could choose, because I was close to home, I could choose to park up the car, go inside, put the cover over my head and sleep. But I said, too much coming. I called Kit. I was like, Kit, I have some vibes. I'm just gonna come down and put on a demo. I don't have the energy to put a lead down, but let me just at least put one in my head. And he was gracious enough to let me come. You know, he has to wake up early in the morning, he's a daddy. So it's like, happy. It's 11 o'clock in the night. Reach inside the studio. So tired, I had to sit, you know? And I sit and I sang the ideas, everything that I had. And then I left like 6 a.m. And then I slept for like half the day, and I opened up and I listened to the bounce that he sent me. I was like, yo, this good. Like, I don't need to do this over. This is like, and that was Hello, right? Out of my lowest moment, like Hello came, like, you know? So it's like, you have to, I call it catching butterflies. You have to be, you see a butterfly, you have to go and find a way. Record it, catch it, because it's not coming back. It's not coming back. And if you miss that, you miss it. It's gone forever. Yeah. So.
And I just wanted to add a note about Hello, that it is the most streamed soca song released from the last decade.
It's crazy.
Which is phenomenal.
Crazy.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Whenever your name comes up, Kees the band, people think success. You're extremely popular. You're extremely well known. I think just those three letters, K-E-S, just brings a vibe. Was there a particular moment that you can remember where you stood on a stage or you were just somewhere and you realized that I'm something, I'm big?
I'm a big deal.
I'm a big deal.
I get pangs a few times. Sometimes, like for our flagship show, I'm like, these people come to see me, boy, oh God. Like, you got like belly walk, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, it's like, it's still so personal. It's still so like, I always remember a story my dad told me about Spoiler, the Calypsonian, and he had two pallet sticks, which is the lolly sticks for those who don't know, you know? And how he would write, he would sit on his pavement and beat a rhythm and write his songs. But it's just him and that, it's just, so a lot of it is just very much in my own, like I don't really, I'll go in nature. I kind of weird in a way, in a sense. I would just like walk and just look at things and hear birds and want to be a fly on the wall. But then when we create something and then everybody notices, I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. You know, so I'm always like still surprised. Do you like that song? Like, what do you like about it? Like, whoa, that look. And like, when the song comes out to you, it's not yours no more. Because people kind of come back with different meanings and different things. And you're like, oh, shit. Then you realize it's not yours in the first place. It was just passing through you. You know? So, and the more I saw that, and the more I worked with other people who were like better than me, better songwriters, they would create an amazing song today and tomorrow. They're done with that. It's like, okay, cool. What are we doing today? You know? And when I was young, I was like, oh, yeah, that was a nice song. For the week, you know, like, a week.
Yeah. Now, in this business, the genre that you're in, you've enjoyed extreme success. But among the elder statesmen of soca and calypso, you command this level of respect that they will all give it to you. And I've hung with them and I've spoke to them, and your name comes up. And it's almost like, yeah, let me open the door for him. He does well. So it's, you're standing on their shoulders, they recognize it, but they also recognize that where they left off and what they were trying to do, you are now in that place and you're doing it. Is there a particular artist or Calypsonian soca artist that inspired you the most? And that's also part of Kizzy. And Kizzy states that she is your biggest fan. And Kizzy, might I add, Kizzy was here extremely early.
Kizzy, bless her. I'm inspired by different artists for different reasons. There's a lot of different people doing cool stuff. One of them that really made me feel that I could get involved was David Rudder. David Michael Rudder. Ooh. King David Michael Rudder.
Yes.
Yeah. He represented a whole heap of things that I loved. You know, in the 80s when he was kind of like on the cusp of being signed and all that stuff, his music, his sound, even his gears and his... He had a way that he created so many dimensions and depth to party music, to calypso, in a time where, yeah, people just wanted a fete. But yet he could sing Haiti, I'm Sorry, or he could sing, you know, the words from Calypso and acknowledge his elders. He also understood that he stood on the shoulders of Melody and Sparrow and Kitchener, mm-hmm. and all of them, and holds them in deep regard. I felt that with him, but his song that caught me was High Mass. And Because at that time, you know, I mean, anytime people, you know, think that carnival is devil thing and all of that and the church, but the, you know, and I was, you know, I was very much into religion at that point in time, mm-hmm. And finding God and stuff like that. And but I love soca too, and I didn't understand, well, how they're not together. So when I heard him sing High Mass, it was like these worlds coming together. I'm like, yes, it's the ultimate exalting, you know? It's like, yes, you could enjoy yourself and have the carnal desires in carnival, but there's so much more to it than that, no? And it's so highly spiritual. It's so much, when the vibration, you look around, you see everybody pulsing. There's something connecting all of us. And, you know, carnival is that you could tune into any level of it. And so what? This is life. You do that. That's carnival.
But it's funny you say that, because you turn around a few years later and you did the exact same thing with Savannah Grass.
Yes. You know what?
In full circle.
Bless. Thank you for that. It's for real, you know? So, yeah, David definitely had that impact. Yeah.
Now, Kees, the band, Kees, you as a performer and songwriter, because of your ability and where the doors that you've basically kicked down, because anything you have now, nobody gave it to you, work extremely hard for it, especially listening to, we thought you came along with Woodless and everything else, not knowing that you had been around for years, going back to Image and Company. In saying that, you've actually taken the genre and introduced it to a non-Caribbean audience. Because mm-hmm. we see the reaction that you get from non-Caribbean persons. We sat back and watched you on the Tamron Hall show, and I can tell you that entire audience, they were not Caribbean people. But the reaction, it says that, you know what? It says that...
I love it.
The music, it's going places. Which takes me to this question. Do you think a non-West Indian, non-Caribbean person can be successful and accepted in the soca calypso industry, part one? And the second part of this person's question is, would you support a Kees the Band cover band or artist?
Wow. For one, some people coming from outside into soca, you're gonna have it harder. It's just what it is. You're gonna have it harder, but it's either gonna do two things, it's either gonna bury you, or you are gonna push harder to make a good song. And I feel like that's important, you know, to find what that is. And it's possible for anyone, but yes, it will be harder for somebody from the outside. No, I think that's gonna change personally, because I see what happened to reggae in that. You know, of course, reggae in Kingston, the lean of the bass, everything, you can't take away that pocket, they have what that is. But I've heard reggae's that I like from Germany, some that I like from Hawaii, some that I like from Trinidad, you know, some I like from St. Thomas and St. Croix. It's reggae. So I feel like when the genre gets bigger, we become less don't touch me thing, you know, like this ours. People are gonna start to play with it more, and then you're gonna have different kind of offshoots, and then yeah, it might be pretty easy for say, I'm gonna do a song in a soca style. You know, and they're gonna do their thing. And you know, I bless all of that, because I feel like, you know, I look at a genre like an arrow, you know. There is the tip that has to pierce new territory and new grounds. There's the body that holds it steady, the meat of it. And then there's the roots, the tail, that guides it. So you need all of them. So you need the ice cream soca or the movie socas, and you need the wicket, bucket, fit. You need that kind of thing on fire. Sort with that, you know? And then you need the kaiso, the lyrics, the things that make us who we are. So, yeah.
And this one, you know, the question we just have, do you want to send out a lovely shout out to you? Empress Destiny and Danielle, they love your energy.
Blessed, I love you too. Goodness. Hey! Nice.
Kees, last Thursday night at the Caribbean Music Awards, yeah. You received the People's Choice Award. a well-deserved honor, yes, and just one of many that you have received and will continue to receive as the years go on. But it was a very beautiful moment also when you presented David Rutter with the Calypso Award that he received. And hearing you, I mean, knowing this from previous interviews, how much he has meant to you as an influence, that was so significant to see you give that award to him here in Brooklyn. And I just wondered what that moment felt like for you.
I mean, he completed a lot of circles, you know? Mm-hmm. To even do that, to even work with him, had a song with him, it's a lot, you know? I'm honored. I still go back. Even today, I was looking at a clip and hearing him talk about things, you know?
Yeah.
So that meant a lot. And, you know, for that award show, again, I'm not a awardee bantan, you know, like, it's all right. I'm appreciative, but this thing is moving so much, you know, that what is success kind of comes into play. Like, you're successful, what does that mean? You know, did you achieve what you wanted to? All of that. So I'm just appreciative that we are now finding ways to bring the diaspora together and appreciate each other, you know? So that meant a lot too, to see that happen, to be backstage and see Barris sitting down, hey, and Dexter there, and a compa man over here, and it's like, wow, it's like all of us here together. I don't ever see this, you know? So that's powerful. A lot of good things could happen backstage in those things.
Definitely. And to Fimber's point about touching audiences beyond Caribbean people, I wanted to talk about back in 2016, I believe it was, when you were signed to Claude Kelly and Chuck Harmony, two American, very successful American producer-songwriting duo. They've written for Rihanna, Britney Spears, so many people. And of the many artists that they could have taken under their wing to do a project, they chose Kes the Band, said, we want to work with you guys and see what can develop, which, you know, to me was just it seemed like such a perfect situation for you to be in, to further what you're doing and take it beyond the core fan base that you have well established. Yeah. But I'm not quite sure what happened there. I know you were writing songs, working on songs. I don't know if anything was ever released, but...
Two.
Okay, so what happened with that project?
So with Claude and Chuck, that was almost like feel like it was a university in a lot of ways, in some aspects. And in some aspects, again, it was sort of leaning towards, yo, what we doing calypso-wise, soca-wise, is important. Mm-hmm. And not that the stuff that we were doing with Claude and them was not, because I had some amazing experiences with them, but I felt like that experience actually just showed us that, you know, as much as we would look to foreign and look to all these things for almost like a savior in some ways, we had a lot of things going for us. We were road warriors. We could have made any situation happen. We were performers. And as much as we would do, you know, the songs and stuff, it was really that our Caribbean vibes that was breaking walls and opening the doors. So I think eventually with Claude and Chuck, they were running a label, but they were also artists. And something is going to suffer when that happens, because you really can't do both at the same time, plus break a new sound, you know? So I felt like we weren't getting the... Like, we were moving steps backward when it came to, like, the momentum that we were doing. So it didn't work out in that way. But what I experienced in that time, what the band experienced in that time, was, like, undeniable. Like, I would do it again, you know, from what I experienced, from the songwriting sessions to actually performing the songs and understanding how the industry works and how things move. And it was school, you know, so
as much as it didn't develop in itself, it plays a role me now of what moves I make, you know, from that experience. Yeah.
And you also had a, during the pandemic when we were, you know, everything shut down, you did this wonderful performance on the Stephen Colbert show, and where they did carnivals around the world, and you did that wonderful performance. I wonder, did, you know, what kind of interest did that performance generate with the great John Batiste kind of curating the whole thing? What did that generate for the band?
First of all, I was very happy and impressed that they would do that.
Yes.
You know, that they would acknowledge the carnivals and bring Trinidad in that fold, you know. It's actually through Etienne Charles. Etienne Charles went to school with Jean Baptiste.
Okay.
And Jean Baptiste was like, yo, we want to do the special segment. But he was also aware of Trinidad. Because, you know, Etienne is also an intellect with respect to history. So I'm sure he gave him, you know, all the history and stuff like that. So when he came with it, you know, we were going to make it happen. You know, we just had to make it happen. All the restrictions, all the different things we had to deal with. But we, again, that's, those are the, like, the opportunities that we know that, hey, we got to nail this, you know. We got to get the proper sound and cameraman and let's get this done properly. And yeah, these things are important because you never know we're going to see it for the first time and be like, what is this, you know? Let me explore more, you know?
Exactly. That's great.
Next question, this person says, I like the energy that Robbie brings to the band. Mm-hmm. Is he energetic at every concert fete? And part two, you recently lost your musical director, Ricardo. Where do you find the strength to continue performing?
Let me deal with Robbie first. I mean, Roberto, he's a light, you know? He's such an angel on and off stage. And he's like somebody who I know I could turn around and watch and he's gonna give me an energy that I need, you know? Much less what he gives to the stage and the crowd. So, you know, again, it's just one of those family members that does their part and, you know, they make it better. They make the whole thing better. So, you know, I'm grateful for Robbie and each member. And what they bring. And Ricardo, you know, Ricardo, you know, it, you never get over somebody losing somebody. You just never do. But what I know now is that purpose has become more. You know, I am carrying his legacy. I am carrying his dreams that he had for us. I am gonna fulfill it, and I'm gonna fulfill it in his name, I'm gonna fulfill it in daddy's name, I'm gonna fulfill it in, you know, all the people who've been there for me and supported me and who are not here with me. It's hard, but he's here. Like, I feel him. I feel his presence in many times, you know? So, in that sense, I feel that me fulfilling what I have to do is honoring him, and it gives me fuel, you know, to do that.
Well, while we're here, let's take the next question, which is along those lines. This person wants to know, what does love mean to you? And she put behind that, real love.
Real love is timeless, you know?
Ah, that's it. What inspired the song Timeless?
All right.
Answer the question.
That's actually true, Nyla. They had a song and they wanted me on it, so we wrote. So they came with that idea. But yes, it is timeless. It's, you know, let's just say love of this craft. I was like, compare it to a slippery fish, you know? You gotta hold on to this fish. This fish might dive deep. It may jump out of the water and be glorious. But you have to work with that, you know? You believe there's a soul connection, that love is just undeniable, you know? And it's not framed by conditions or time. You just love where you love, you know? And it's you within yourself following your truth or not, you know?
Now, we were chatting back stage earlier, and you mentioned that your father, from the time you guys were young, you had your own little makeshift costumes and bands, and you were behind the speakers sleeping and all that. You think that prepared you for a career in soca? And since mom had such a rich musical background, what made you choose soca versus another genre?
I think soca find me in a lot of ways. You know, soca find me. Soca let me do. All right, go and do. Go and sing your rock and go and do your things, you know. But when it was time, I felt like it did call me, you know, through these other artists and seeing them and seeing. And then daddy, yeah, definitely had us, you know, playing old mass, 4 o'clock in the morning, you're 6 years old. Sleeping in a wall of speakers, you know, those things were so important, you know, and to see him in action, you know, I never knew how that left an impact on me because, you know, old mass and juve and thing, a lot of people getting drunk and like they fall out of character. And he used to get so mad for that, like.
But you said, what did he do, his profession?
He's an accountant.
An accountant.
And a bacchanalist, yes. Two of them, hand in hand.
That'll go together, an accountant and a bacchanalist.
You have some Gemini somewhere going on there. Yeah, he's both of them things. But more a bacchanalist than an accountant, you know? If he could have sang, he would have been like an Calypsonian, for sure, you know? He had us in mass camp, he had us, you know, we would just be everywhere, you know? He had a way that he taught us the streets, you know? Mom was more of the grace, taught us about patience and grace and that kind of aspect, you know? Daddy taught us about scribbling outside the lines, please, you know? Do as you want, you know, in that way, yeah.
Did your dad, was he part of the inspiration of Savannah Grass, or was he someone you turned to as you kind of put that song together, knowing, you know, his love of Bacchanal, his love of, you know, mass and everything with that? It seemed like he might have played a role in that in some way.
Every song that I kind of get more into the culture, I go to dad, you know, I go to him. I always remember, you know, his health was declining, but he was still like, you know, he was in his TV room. He'd be sitting in the TV room and there's this window and then there's a yard. And I'd go out in the yard and talk to him through the window because I'd be in the backyard. I'll have my speaker there. I'd be playing my rhythms, writing, you know. And then I'd be like, dad, hear this, hear this, hear this, hear this. So I'd play it for him and he would, I remember he just listened and then he's like, as I hit. And I was like, for real, boss, you really like it? He was like, yeah, that's a hit. And then as, you know, he got sicker and sicker, the song was completing too, the same time. And I felt like his essence was going into the song as like, he passing and he living in his song, and I felt like this thing happening, you know? And like, he passed away and we had the funeral. And like the Friday, right afterwards, we did the video, you know, raw. It was Ollie, the director, Shane, his DP, and a skateboard and his camera. That was it. We just went around the savannah and did everything. But we were, I mean, I crying in between, I like. Yeah. But, you know, the greatest art does come out of the most pain.
Right.
It's one common thing I learned, you know? And that again was that. He lives in his song now. Like, that's him. Ops.
What a year that must have been for you, 2019, because losing a parent is, you know, one of the most pivotal moments in one's life and one of the saddest and just, you know, something you years to process. But at the same time, you have this song, Savannah Grass. Not only was it a big hit, you've had those before, but this was being hailed as one of the greatest calypsos of all time, and how you pulled from you know, what came before, and you just can't channel this ancestral vibe of all the Calypsonians who came before into this piece of music that just was, you know, everywhere, played everywhere. So you have the high of that, and then you have these unbelievable lows going through such a profound loss. I mean, how did you balance those two things?
That year taught me, I don't know how I did it. I was zombieing a little bit, in a sense. I was sort of giving my all, and then sort of like switching off. And finding later on in the year, I kind of was dealing with it, you know? But it broke a lot of, it broke a lot of patterns and past concerns and stuff like that. Like, it became about the music and the art. It didn't be all the frills and all the little anxieties and all those things. I just totally divorced from certain aspects of the industry that sometimes we cage ourselves in, because nothing else mattered about just getting through. I just wanted to get through the season. I didn't care about people liking me or liking my song or being popular. Or none of that mattered. The only thing that mattered was representing what's in my heart right now and who here. You know, if you're here, it's cool. And that is me now. Like, I never left that. Like, that's the most important thing. Mm-hmm. And if that's not in place, then it's a waste of time for me, you know? So it changed me, you know? It changed me, you know? The pain switched my course a bit, you know?
We have, it's Pat question and Pat comment. Hello, handsome Kes. My name is it Lila? Silal, do you meet deaf, I guess she wants to know, have you ever met a deaf soca fan before? She's the first, and she's sitting right here.
Wow.
I always love to listen to your beautiful songs every day, and I am glad to meet you. And she has a shirt.
This is amazing. I'd love to know, like, how it feels, like, what is that? So I would love to hear more about, wow. That's amazing.
Super. This one is from Joan B. What keeps you centered and helps you to maintain your blessed nature and disposition? When you're on the stage, how do you come down? What do you do to chill?
Simplicity. Keep it simple. You know? Enjoy the simple things. Those are the most powerful things, whether it's family, whether it's nature, whatever does bring you recharge. Like, there was a point in time when I was, as your mother would say, burning your candle up two wicks, you know, two ends. You're on stage, but you're liming, and you're like, I had to kind of choose what my off time was going to be because I need to refill to do what I have to do well. So, you know, I always loved nature as a kid, but now I kind of coming back to my kid days. I never left that, but now I'm like, Saturday, I by the river, you know? That's my excursion. I pack food and whatever. It's like, going, you know? And but in that place, I would, two lines will come to a song that I was looking for like 4 months, you know? But I needed to empty myself again, like sort of like understand that I am a piece in this big thing and feel what that is as well and sort of like remind myself of that, and that's what I do now to keep me. It's crazy that the more the ball rolls, is the more quiet you get. Like I understand artists now, certain artists who sort of like turn to recluse in a way, because you become so sensitive to like energy and people, like it becomes difficult sometimes to like be overstimulated and over. You know, I have to like simplify my life off stage, you know, and it helps.
Yes. This is going to be my last question and then for you, Pat.
Right.
This is a two-part question. How would you go about introducing soca music to young children of non-Caribbean descent in a way that is developmentally appropriate? And two, thoughts on the appropriateness of some soca themes for them?
Yeah. I think first off is, one, expose them to it. You know, again, kids may listen to it now and be like, I always remember I used to sing with Michelle Xavier, and she had a nephew from Canada, and he came to soundcheck, and he was like 6 years old, and he was like, what is this soca crap? And I was so like, I laughed, but because he's so brutally honest, you know? And like, but then you see him now, he can't wait to come carnival. Like, he's coming and he fat 16. You wanna meet some girls, you wanna meet, you wanna feel the vibes, he loved the show. He was like, I seen him jumping up like a maniac. I like, you little, you remember? Like, and so to me, it's kind of like, yes, the exposure, the education of it, tell these stories as well. But I think we need to tell these stories to our kids. We need to practice kind of, you know, like do that first, because yes, we could always find ways to sort of try and educate the world. Like, yes, Trinidad is not a part of Jamaica, and you know, all of these things. All these little talking points that we need to get through before we get into what soca is, right? But you know, as well, yes, we need to adopt that in our own culture, because I think we sort of like, you know, it takes a village to raise a child, but we sort of like, we haven't realized that the safety net is not guaranteed. Like, that could wash away unless we maintain it, unless we feed it, unless we, you know, support it. So kids need to know the stories. Like, only when I went, I did a little course with a professor, one of my friends in UTT over the COVID, that I learned a lot of the cool history that soca artists don't know about. And so it's like, I feel like we need to take pride in that. You know, when I was in a dance in Jamaica, and I went to Slippery Nipple Tuesdays in Waterhouse. And it was in this little dance, and it was like kind of two-level house and, you know, community dance. But opposite the road was like, it's King Tubby's studio. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's like a shrine. Like, they have it like a shrine in the middle. So, like, these kids know who King Tubby is. They know his role, you know. We need to celebrate ourselves. Not every, you know, pave paradise and put up a parking lot. Like, we need to know what we have, and that the world travels to come and experience and feel this and see this. And so it's a maturity that we need to build, you know?
Yeah, I so agree with that as far as, you know, as a traveler to the Caribbean so often, and Port of Spain, you know, you walk around, you see these addresses where certain calypso tents would have been in, yes, like the 1930s, 40s, where, mm-hmm, Houdini, these mythical names, you know, but that this is where they started. And you think that how, if this history was preserved, these, at the very least, have a plaque above the door, say this was such and such, yes, calypso tent or whatever, yeah, it just helps to that continuity of it. And I feel like it's such a musical place, like the richness that from between the pan and the, yeah, calypso, the soca that has, mm, come from there, like Kingston with its reggae and dancehall, yeah, and dub, but in Port of Spain, that, you know, there should just be a lot more business revolving around what a musical nucleus that
it
is, you know.
I feel like our oil and drugs and all these things that provide money in Trinidad, you know, the doctors, the lawyers, because we celebrate that as well. We have those opportunities. Music became a second class. That music became like, so what is doing the day? Like, mm-hmm, if you're not in an office, like, they, people confuse, you know, that you do music for a living. What is that about? And I think we battle a lot of those things, you know, of sort of breaking that mentality. And I think a lot of people in Trinidad don't know how impactful the music is outside of the shores. Like, they just think, well, carnival time, they put it on. Good songs are like Dirty Rags in a way, like, cool, 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 it's nice. Where you coming with me? Yeah, for next year. Like, 3 months later, you know? And it's like, you know, enjoy it, enjoy it. But we're so blessed, we're almost spoiled in a way, you know? Mm. And I feel like other islands depended on tourism and depended on their craft. They didn't have attendees to, or uncle who had a, is either this working or I gonna join a gang, you know? Or I gonna work for my dad or something like that. You know, that sort of fight sort of is a different mentality. Now you would preserve, like, wow, like, this person made it, so I want everybody to make it too, and how are we going to do that? Trinidad is like, you know, you could sing nice, man. Like, I always say, like, if Adele was born in Carnage, like, you know, I tell her to, hey, sing a song with Kesan Marshall, man. And there was, like, no place for, like, we don't know what to do with talent. You know, we don't know what to do. So that needs to improve, the bridges, the education. We just need to keep on doing those things and setting examples, you know, trying our best in every way, supporting others who are doing that too, you know. And I think that's happening slowly in different ways because new avenues have opened up, you know, so, yeah.
And before we conclude, I just wanted to mention that in, I believe it was 2021, you released the album, yeah. We Home.
Yes.
Which wonderful album with the live recordings of great,
really. Big up to Ricky for that one, for real.
Beautiful, beautiful job. And that was with Ineffable Records, a California-based label.
Yes.
And are you working on another record? I believe you have a single that's going to drop tomorrow.
Tomorrow. So
let's talk about that.
Yes. And that's actually a song on the project. It's called Man With No Door. And it's just sort of like a song that, an album of work, a body of work that is almost a kind of introduction, I would say, into how free I am feeling creatively. So certain songs are going to be in the album, like Jolene, Licky Ticky, you know, this new one. Job Job going to be in it as well, too. But there are other tracks that's not soca, you know? So it's kind of like, yes, soca, but the application of soca, the application of calypso as well. And, you know, I just always been free creatively, and I'm looking, just excited about putting it all together, you know? So Man With No Door, I met a man with no door, and he was very fascinating. People from around the world would come to his house, you know, and he never had a door, ever. And his story was so great, and I felt creatively I feel like that, you know. And so that album, I'm looking forward to getting that together. We may be releasing it, kind of like tying it with Carnival as well, too, so, you know, stay tuned for what that is, but soon enough. It's almost done and wrapped and ready to go.
Great. Yeah. We look forward to it.
Nice.
Great. Guys, unfortunately, we were not able to get to all the questions since we had so many, but I do hope you enjoyed the ones that we were able to ask and you got some answers that you're satisfied with. Kes, I know I speak for the Brooklyn Public Library when I say you always have a home here. And
thank you.
And on behalf of the Tropicalfete family, we want to sincerely thank you for making this one of your stops while you're here in New York. We enjoyed the experience.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for coming up. And hopefully we can do this again very soon. You have a lot to tell.
Yeah. Yes, yes. Thank you. And thank you for doing this. This is important.
Thank you. What did you say?
I miss you from the time you went away. Ah, baby, oh. I love never felt this type of way. Oh, Lord, when you give me that wine, piece of body where you got, no, you fire, baby. So you love for design, yeah.
Only you got the thing I desire, baby. But look how you love it, come back again. Make me feel some type of way. Sending a message straight to my brain. Feel like being in Bamba Day. And anytime you come around, I'll be the one to give you love. You know I must come back. All I want you say, come, come, wine, give me banga, banga.
Ladies and gentlemen, you lead too. Vocalists with Kees, the band, international superstar, Kees. Thank you so very much, my brother.
Let's thank you, everybody.